Hi everyone, I am here to present our work Near Optimal Learning of Tree Structure Distributions by Chow Liu with Arna Bhattacharya, Eric Price and N.V. Vinod Chandran. This is a work on learning high-dimensional distributions. Let T be a distribution over the Boolean hypercube which is unknown to us, and we are getting independent samples from this distribution. Our goal will be to learn a distribution P hat such that the KL distance between P and P hat in that order is at most epsilon for some parameter epsilon with high probability. But the KL distance between these two distributions P and P hat in that order is defined as the expectation of the logarithm of the ratio between the two probability mass functions, but the expectation is taken with respect to the first distribution. Now in general, this problem of learning high dimensional distribution is known to be provably intractable in the following two sense. Firstly, statistically, it's known that 2 to the n samples are needed in the worst case. And computationally, even to write the distribution p hat, we need 2 to the n time in general. In order to evade these hardness results, statistical model assumptions are made about the unknown distribution p. Two such popular assumptions include that p is a Bayesian network or p is a Markov network. And these networks are used to model gene regulatory network in bioinformatics, and also used in machine learning, robotics, and causality. Our focus for this talk will be a special case of these two networks, which is called tree structure distributions. Such a distribution P is defined with respect to an undirected tree over the n nodes 1 to up to n. And in this distribution P, for any three variables I, j, and k, we say the variable I and j are conditionally independent on the variable k if the variable k lies on the unique path between I and j in the tree T. In the below, I have shown here such a tree structure distribution defined on the tree, which is a path on the three nodes. In this tree, the variable 2 lies in between the unique path between 1 and 3. Therefore, for any distribution defined on this tree structure, the variable 3 will be conditionally independent of the variable 1 conditioned on the variable 2. Now, given samples from such an unknown distribution, our goal will be to recover this particular structure. We are not necessarily interested to recover the exact structure, but an approximate structure would be sufficient for us. More formally, we define the epsilon approximate tree as follows. For any distribution P and for any tree T, let P subscript T denote the distribution Q that is firstly defined on a tree structure T. And secondly, it achieves the minimum KL distance from P among all distributions which have tree structure T. We'll be referring to this distribution P subscript T as the projection of P onto the tree T. Firstly, P is really a tree structure distribution. In that case, our goal will be to output a tree T hat such that P's projection to T hat is at most epsilon. On the other hand, if P is not a tree structure distribution, let T star be one base tree for the unknown distribution P, such that T star achieves the minimum KL projection from P among all the tree structures T prime that are possible. And then our goal will be to output a tree T hat, such that P's projection to T hat is at most epsilon worse than the best possible projection to a tree structure that P can have. So in both cases, we'll be referring to the tree T hat as the epsilon approximate tree for the unknown distribution P. Now, once the tree T hat is recovered, learning the conditional distributions according to T hat is relatively easy. We'll be skipping that for this talk and only focus on the structure learning aspect. For the details, I would like you to refer to our paper. Now, this problem of structure learning goes back to the work of Chow and Liu from 1968. They showed this very important equation written above, which says that for any distribution P and for any tree S, the projection of P onto the tree S is exactly some constant which is independent of the particular tree minus the sum of the mutual information over the edges of S. Therefore, it follows that if we want to minimize the KL, it is same as maximizing the sum of mutual information of the tree edges. And that's exactly the algorithm Chow and Liu gave they said that if we take the maximum spanning tree with respect to mutual information between all pairs of variables of P, then the tree obtained P in such a manner will be a true tree structure for P, which is also called the skeleton for P. That's the algorithm we follow in this work. But one thing we immediately notice is that we don't have the true mutual information between the pairs, because that would require an infinite amount of samples. Therefore, we use what is most natural. We take a certain number of samples and we just use the mutual information of the empirical distribution obtained from the samples. For this algorithm, our results are stated informally in this slide. Firstly, we show that if P is not tree structured, then any algorithm for recovering an approximate tree would take something like quadratic in n samples. And the sufficiency for this n square bound for the binary case was known previously. And we also show that if P is tree structured, then we can go linear in the number of samples, which are both necessary and sufficient, as we show in this paper. In running time in both the cases is n square times the number of samples that just comes from this maximum spanning tree construction on this all possible variables. In more detail, our results hold for any general alphabet, not for the Boolean alphabet, but we'll focus on the Boolean alphabet for simplicity throughout this talk. We work with the distance function KL because through Pinsker's inequalities that gives an upper bound for total variation and Hellinger, these matrices. And also we show it almost tight sample complexity of n over epsilon, log n over epsilon, showing both upper and lower bounds. I'll go into more details of our results now. First, we'll talk about our upper bound for the tree structured case. For illustrations, it will be interesting to focus on the following example of three variable tree structured distribution. In the left, I have shown two tree structures, T1 and T2. Let T1 be the true tree structure. Let P be a distribution which is defined on this graph T1. But suppose, due to our empirical mutual information algorithm, we do not obtain the tree T1, but obtain the tree T2 when we take the maximum spanning tree. Then it follows from the Chow Liu equation I showed you earlier that P's projection to the tree T2 is exactly the difference of mutual information of the edges XY and XZ. Now, if this difference is at most epsilon, there is nothing to prove, because we have already obtained a tree which is at most epsilon approximate. More importantly, what we show is that if this difference is at least epsilon, then in roughly 1/epsilon samples, Chow Liu would prefer the edge XY over the edge XZ with high probability. And the underlying reason is that the empirical mutual informations X hat, Y hat, and X hat, Z hat are correlated in a nice way, so that when we want to test for their difference, it is much easier than to learn them individually up to an epsilon additive error. Because such an additive estimation is known to require an inverse quadratic number of samples in epsilon, whereas what we achieve here is the inverse linear number of samples in epsilon. And this saving comes from a conditional mutual information argument. So we'll take a detour of conditional mutual information. Let X, Y, Z be three variables distributed jointly according to some distribution P. Then the conditional distribution of I of XY condition on Z is defined to be the expected conditional mutual information of the I of XY conditioned on when Z is fixed to some particular value Z, and the expectation is taken with respect to the marginal distribution of Z, where the mutual information I of XY condition on Z equal to Z is the joint mutual information of XY in the conditional distribution P of XY condition on Z equal to Z. Now there is a nice chain rule for mutual information that tells us that the sum of the mutual information XY plus the sum of XZ condition on Y is the same as I of XZ plus I of XY condition on Z. And using this equation, we convert our difference of mutual information to a difference of conditional mutual information. For the true distribution, we have assumed this quantity is at least epsilon, because as we have mentioned before, if it is at most epsilon, there is nothing to prove. We can do a similar transformation from mutual information to conditional mutual information also for the empirical distribution using the same chain rule. So what we claim here is whenever the true difference is at least epsilon, the empirical difference will be at least some positive quantity. So this is essentially goes to a problem of testing conditional mutual informations. And we show the following testing results. Let X, Y, Z be three variables distributed jointly according to some distribution P. Then the empirical conditional mutual information of roughly 1/ε samples would distinguish the following two cases with high probability. In the first case, if the conditional mutual information is exactly zero, then the empirical value will stay at most ε/10. If the conditional mutual information is at least epsilon, then the empirical conditional mutual information will be at least ε/3. So that there is a theta epsilon gap between these two cases. For simplicity, in this talk, we'll be focusing on a tester for mutual information, which is essentially the same guarantee we have shown previously, except that we are dropping the conditioning variable Z from the both the cases. So we'll now understand our tester, mutual information tester, with the help of two simple examples. Firstly, consider the case when X is distributed according to a uniform random bit, and Y flips X with probability P. Then the mutual information I of XY between these two variables is exactly log 2 minus the Shannon entropy function at P. And for the testing problem, we notice that this equation for I of XY is almost a quadratic function centered around the value P equal to 1/2. And the mutual information of 0 is achieved exactly at P equal to 1/2. And mutual information is at least epsilon whenever P is at least square root epsilon away from this 1/2. And these two cases are always possible to distinguish using 1/ε samples from Chernoff bound. Now we'll go to the second example. Here X is distributed marginally according to the Bernoulli P, and Y always copies X. In this case, it is not hard to see that I of XY is exactly the Shannon entropy function at P. And in this case, I of XY is 0 at the two boundary values P equal to 0 and 1. And I of XY is at least epsilon when P is at least ε/log 1/ε away from 0 or 1. In either case, we can test for this quantity with inverse of this gap ε/log 1/ε. So that it can be tested with again 1/ε/log 1/ε samples. And this particular example turns out to be tight for our tester. More generally, we show the following guarantee that I promised previously, that whenever the true mutual information is zero, the empirical mutual information will stay at most ε/10. And whenever the mutual information is at least epsilon, the empirical value will stay at least ε/3. Then we go to the conditional mutual information conditioning on the variable Z. This essentially follows from our mutual information tester together with an averaging argument. And this brings in a sample complexity factor, which is size of the sample space of Z. But the guarantees will remain the same. Now, suppose we have such a conditional mutual information tester. I will go back to the three variable example that I showed in the beginning, and we'll see how our tester distinguishes these two conditional mutual information and hence gives the desired guarantee for Chernoff. So as we said before, for the true distribution, we have the difference of conditional mutual information at least epsilon. And for the empirical distribution, we want to show that the same difference is going to be at least some positive quantity. That's what we claim here. Whenever the difference of the mutual information is at least epsilon, that implies the empirical difference is at least some positive quantity. Now in the true distribution, we notice that Y lies in between the unique path between X and Z. So that X and Z are conditionally independent of Y, and we can conclude that X and Z condition on Y is exactly zero. And that gives us, since the difference of conditional mutual information is at least epsilon, I of x, y condition on z is at least epsilon. By our conditional mutual information tester guarantee, we get that whenever the true value is zero, it will stay at most epsilon over 10. Whenever the true value is at least epsilon, it will stay at least epsilon over 3 with high probability. So that whenever we take their difference, it will stay at least something like epsilon over 5. And that gives us that the I of x hat y hat minus I of x hat z hat will also stay at least epsilon over 5 with high probability. And whenever that happens, Chow Liu will pick the right tree. So this argument we only show for 3 variables, but it nicely extends to n variables using some properties of the maximum spanning tree. I'll skip that details for this talk and would like you to refer to our paper. It essentially scales the sample complexity by a factor of n. Now I will mention our lower bounds. Firstly, we show that if P is not a tree structured distribution, then something like n square epsilon to the minus 2 samples are needed in order to learn an epsilon approximate tree with 2/3 probability in the worst case. And then we also show that if P is itself tree structured, then we'll need at least n epsilon to the minus 1 samples for learning an epsilon approximate tree with 2/3 probability. And this in particular shows that our upper bound for tree structured distribution is almost tight. So for the first lower bound, n square epsilon to the minus 2 lower bound for not tree structured distribution, that's what we'll go next in detail. So for that lower bound, we define 3 distributions, P, Q, and R. Each of these distribution use an independent coin B distributed according to Bernoulli half. In the distribution P, X and Y copies B with 3/4 plus epsilon probability and otherwise follows Bernoulli half with the remaining probability. The third variable Z copies B with slightly lesser probability and otherwise follows the Bernoulli half. In Q, X and Z follow the independent coin B with slightly higher probability, and Y copies it with slightly lesser probability. Distribution R is the remaining one, where X copies the bit B with the slightly lesser probability. One can show that all these distributions P, Q, and R is at least epsilon far from tree structure distribution. So they are not tree structure. Whenever we talk about the marginal distribution on the variables X, Y, and Z, and we kind of hide this bit B. If we focus on the distribution P, we can see that in the distribution P, X and Y are copying B with the higher probabilities. Therefore, it is not surprising that X and Y has the highest correlation among the 3 possible pairs of this distribution. Therefore, whenever we talk about the best tree structure for this distribution P, we cannot but put the edge XY in the tree structure because it's the highest correlated pair. And it's not surprising that T1 and T2 are the equally best trees for P. And we talk about the other tree, T3, which misses the edge XY. Using calculation, we can show that it is at least epsilon bad for P. In more detail, if we talk about P's projection on T3 minus P's projection to T1 using the Chow Liu equation, this is basically the difference of the mutual information between I of XY and I of YZ. And that we can show at least epsilon using some calculations. What it shows is that the tree T3 is epsilon bad for the distribution P, and the other 2 distributions are equally best for P. Similarly, we can show that the T2 is epsilon bad for Q, and T1 is epsilon bad for the distribution R. So we have that all these 3 trees are epsilon bad for exactly one of these distributions. Now what we can do is select one of these 3 distributions at random. And then if there is a hypothetical algorithm that learns an epsilon approximate tree, that would rule out an incorrect tree that we have not chosen at random with at least 4/5 probability. But we claim that job of ruling out an incorrect tree needs at least epsilon to the minus 2 samples. And the argument is that, let's say we talk about the distribution P, in this distribution P, even if we reveal the unknown bit, hidden bit B, together with the three samples X, Y, and Z, it basically X is copying B with probability 3/4 plus epsilon, plus half times 1/4 minus epsilon. And with the remaining probability, half times 1/4 minus epsilon, it is basically flipping B. So even if I reveal B with every sample of P, we can detect whether X has flipped or not, Y has flipped or not, and Z has flipped or not. And two of them will flip with probability 1/2 times 1/4 minus epsilon, and one of them will flip with probability 1/4 plus epsilon. Similarly, for Q and R, only one of them will flip the bit B with probability 1/2 times 1/4 plus epsilon, and otherwise they will copy the bit B. And if we see B with each sample, we can reveal whether these three bits have flipped or not. And this is exactly a problem of deciding between the coins flipping, whether it's flipping with probability 1/2 times 1/4 minus epsilon, or its bias is 1/2 times 1/4 plus epsilon. And this we can always distinguish using epsilon to the minus 2 samples from Chernow bound, and that's also known to be tight. We cannot do much better than a random guess, which would achieve a 2/3 probability of success, ruling out an incorrect one. So that if we want to achieve a success of 4/5 probability, that will need something like epsilon to the minus 2 samples. Now we make n independent copies of this construction, and we get our desired n square epsilon to the minus 2 bound whenever we have n variables. So I'll briefly conclude with some interesting directions for future work. Firstly, in this work, we have shown an approximate structure recovery algorithm for tree structure distribution. But obtaining an approximate structure learning algorithm for general Bayes' nets is more harder, because in Bayes' net, we can have more than one parent for every variable, and it requires us to consider higher order interactions between variables. Secondly, in this work, we only focused on the discrete case, but continuous tree structure distributions such as continuous graphical models, such as Gaussian Bayesian networks, structure learning for those high dimensional distributions remain an interesting question. So that's all we have for this talk, and thanks you for your kind attention.